Okay. Okay, this is the second half on our study on the kings of Judah, but we're also, as we talked about the kings of Judah, I don't have my video on, do I?
Nope, you haven't had it on.
All right, let me turn it on. Okay. So we are... can you read the top of that, the first line?
Yeah.
Read it. Yeah, read it, please. I can't see it. I can't see it.
Wicked King Joram, son of Jehoshaphat. You want me to keep going?
That's good. Jehoram became king, and he was not a good guy at all. And it says his mother's name was Athaliah, the granddaughter of Omri. Now, you remember from last week that Ahab was the worst king ever of Israel in the northern kingdom. And his father happened to be named Omri. And so what we have here is an intermarriage between the kings of Judah and the kings of Israel. And this woman, Athaliah, is a granddaughter, which means that Ahab was her father, Jezebel was her mother. She's married into the Judean line, and so is because of her influence, her son is a wicked guy like her dad, Ahab. And so it was never, you know, they never should have intermarried, but they did. And so they've brought the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, into Judah. And so he acts just like an Israel king, setting up golden calves and worshiping, burning incense on the mountains and all that kind of stuff. So Jehoram dies young, and his mother takes it upon herself to try to murder every living descendant of King David. So she's a lot like Jezebel, her mother. And in verse 10 there on the bottom, Athaliah, the mother of Ahaziah, saw her son was dead. She rose and destroyed all the royal offspring of the house of Judah. But Jehoshabeth, the king's daughter, took Joash, the son of Ahaziah, and stole him from among the king's sons. So she literally kidnapped the prince. And the prince at this time is still nursing. So she gets the boy's nurse and she hides the kid out. And so during this time period, Ahab's daughter, Athaliah, excuse me, is ruling in Judah for 6 years. That's a nice story for Sunday school. You'll see that the kings of Judah, it's hit and miss with them. Some of them were really bad. Some of them were really good. In the 52nd year of Azariah, who's also named Uzziah, if you have an old version that you're using, it probably says Uzziah. It was funny, as I was reading down and putting this on the PowerPoint, and I got to the end, and I said to myself, where's Uzziah? And I went and searched in the New American Standard, and it's not there in Kings. It's mentioned in one of the prophets that there was prophesying during the reign of Uzziah. And so I see that in the modern translation, it is translated Azariah, which is a similar name. So during this time, Pekah, the son of Remaliah, came over Israel and Samaria and reigned 20 years. He's an evil guy too. Continues to do the sins of Jeroboam. And so in the days of Pekah and in the days of Azariah, Here we have Tiglath-Pileser, the king of Assyria, comes down. He captures the nation of Israel, and it says in Galilee, in the land of Naphtali. Zebulun and Naphtali are the areas in which Jesus was raised. It was called Galilee at the time, but it was divided among these two sons of Israel, and they're carried away captive to Assyria. We talked about this last week, how he took half the people to Assyria, and he sent people from Assyria down there so that the people would intermarry amongst themselves and theoretically make him strong, or make it strong for his kids in the next generation because they were intermarried, and it'd be easier to control a people if they're relatives. So here we have the destruction of Israel and the sparing of Judea for quite a long time after this. They continued after Israel was gone. Any questions on that? Jim, I cannot hear you. Maybe it's me. Let me see if
I. No, it's not.
Okay.
So then, who was the king of Judea at the time if Israel was taken over by Samaria?
Azariah.
Okay.
Uzziah or Azariah, depending on which name is used for him.
All right.
Okay. Now we have Joash is king. Doesn't say much about him. We got a couple here. We have four kings that were uneventful, status quo kind of people. So I'm not really going to talk about them. There's nothing that can be gained from talking about their reign, so I'm going to skip over it because we've got more important things to do. So we come to Ahaz. This is from Isaiah. It came about in the days of Ahaz, the son of Jotham, the son of Uzziah. See, there his other name is used. King of Judah. That Rezin, the king of Aram, and Pekah, the son of Remaliah, king of Israel, went up to Jerusalem to wage war against it, but could not conquer it. When it was reported to the house of David, the Arameans have camped in Ephraim, and the hearts of the people shook as the trees of the forest shake. Then the Lord said to Isaiah, go to meet Ahaz, you and your son Shear Jeshub, at the end of the conduit of the upper pool on the highway to the fuller's field. And say to him, take care, be calm, have no fear, do not be faint-hearted because of these two stubs of smoldering firebrands. In other words, you know, there's nothing, there's a little bit of flame there left on them, but there's not much left. On the account of the fierce anger of Rezin and Aram, the son of Remaliah, because Aram, that's Syria, with Ephraim, that's Israel, and the son of Remaliah, who's the king, has planned evil against you, saying, let us go up against Jerusalem and terrorize it, make for ourselves a breach in its walls, and set up the son of Tabeel as king in the midst of it. The Lord says, it shall not stand, nor shall it come to pass. So Israel, whatever is left of Israel, it's just a smoking firebrand, and the Syrians are coming, and they're trying to take over Jerusalem, and the people are shaking. And Isaiah the prophet goes to the fuller's field and says, it isn't going to happen. Don't worry about it. Now, who knows what the next verses are? Isaiah says to Uzziah, ask for a sign. And Uzziah says, I won't test the Lord. I won't ask for a sign, which was a spiritual mumbo jumbo, because, you know, he's not following the Lord correctly. And so he knows that he's not supposed to test the Lord. So he makes the right answer. And then the prophet says, the Lord himself shall give you a sign. A virgin shall bear a son and name him Emmanuel. So this is where that passage comes from. And the Jews are very critical of a Christian interpretation of this, because, you know, it's to use it as the proof that God says that a virgin will bear a child is difficult, because for two reasons. For one reason, it's out of context. And secondly, they say that it means a young woman of marriageable age, not necessarily a virgin. Well, when it was translated into Greek, when the New Testament and the, or excuse me, the Old Testament was translated into Greek, in the Greek it says virgin. And at this time, a young woman of marriageable age would almost certainly be a virgin. So it's on kind of shaky ground with Jews, but it is used as a passage to say, see here in the Old Testament talks about a virgin birth. So in the midst of this war between Israel and Judah and Syria, this prophecy comes. Do you have anything to say about that?
Well, if it was referring to just a young woman, there would be no reason why that could be a sign from God.
That's true.
Right.
So whether it translates virgin or not, it's obvious that that's what's implying.
That's true. So here we have, there are prophets before this, but here in this time period, there are prophets everywhere. And Isaiah is a little bit ahead of the curve. Here it is. He appears at the time of Assyria's destruction of Israel, and yet Isaiah is a royal prophet. There's ordinary prophets and royal prophets. Royal prophets prophesy to the kings directly. The ordinary prophets prophesy to the people. And they're all critical of the kings, the things that the kings are doing wrong, the problems in the kingdom. And so we have basically a conservative and a liberal wing of scripture. And if you look at the political, the religious liberals who are also political liberals, the reason that they're political liberals is because they revere the Hebrew prophets highly and the things that the Hebrew prophets said. A lot of them don't believe in the miraculous. And if you take the miraculous out, what are you left with? You're left with social commentary. And so this started way, way, way back when, and we shouldn't be surprised that there are people that are calling out the problems in society. Although I don't think that people that are calling out the problems in society today are necessarily giving the proper fix for it, because they're ignoring some of the morality. They're ignoring the sexual immorality. They're ignoring the worshiping and burning incense on every hill and so forth. And so they're not picking up on those, but they're picking up on, treating all people correctly and stuff like that. So in that sense, the liberals are right. We should be treating everybody the same. We should not be discriminating against people and so forth. And, you know, the obscene wealth that some people have and some people don't have enough to eat. And they're right about that, but the solution is not necessarily a good solution. The proper solution would be for everybody to take care of those who are around them and not be taxed out of it against their will. So Isaiah is a little bit ahead of the deportation to Babylon. And when we get to Jeremiah was a royal prophet. He spoke to the kings, the king Jehoiakim and some of the others. So this is a little bit later, but I'm just giving you a background of it now. So Jeremiah was a prophet to the kings, and Ezekiel was a priest. When the Babylonians eventually did come and destroy Judah, Jeremiah was given an option. The king, Nebuchadnezzar, and his people said, okay, because you've been telling the truth, you can stay in the land. And what Jeremiah was saying is, go to Babylon, submit to the king, live your life, and learn not to do the things that you did before, and God will bring you back. And so he was not carried to Babylon, but Ezekiel was. And he writes from a priestly perspective. And then, of course, Daniel himself was carried away. And so these are all about 100 years later. And the prophets that we have, the minor prophets, three of them are after the Babylonian captivity. That's Zephaniah, Zechariah, and Malachi. All the rest prophesied during this time, and they either prophesied to the kings of Israel or to the kings of Judah. And so there's kind of a back and forth between all of that. So the whole second section of the Bible is, and by far the most writing in the Bible, is around this coming Babylonian captivity period, how it came about, what happened when it was done. And then afterwards, we have Esther, Ezra, and Nehemiah when they came back and rebuilt. And then after that, we have 400 years of silence. And so enter Isaiah. And I don't have time to talk about Isaiah. I mean, we could talk about Isaiah for a year easily, but Isaiah is actually three books that have been compiled together. But in the early section, chapters 1 through 40, that's all written at this particular time period. And then some of the other stuff is written later. Any questions on that? So we come to Ahaz had an alliance with Assyria. Therefore, they didn't destroy them. But he has his son Hezekiah. And Hezekiah was a very good king. And there's a lot of things here about this guy that we could talk about. There's good preaching material here, Deb, if you're interested in doing some Old Testament preaching. So we see that this comes in the third year of Hoshea, the son of Elah, king of Israel, that Hezekiah, the son of Ahaz, becomes king of Judah. He's young. He's 25 years old. He reigned 29 years. His mother's name was Abi, the son of Zechariah. He did right in the sight of the Lord according to all that his father David had done. Good guy. So he gets sick, and he prays, and the prophet comes and says, okay, God is adding 15 years to your life. Well, I'm 65. I'd like 15 more years. That'd be cool. I'd like to live to be 80. He obviously didn't want to die, and so he prays, and he had some sort of a boil, and they laid, I think, a fig leaf or something on the boil, or a fig, and it cured, and he was given an extra 15 years of life. Old Testament miracle for a good guy. Why do some prayers get answered and some prayers don't get answered? So let's talk about this. Manasseh was 12 years old, and he was the worst king ever. What if his father had died 15 years earlier? I mean, when you do a deep reading of these, I mean, there's a lot of stuff here. I mean, we're just skimming the surface of some of this stuff. He did all the wicked things. He killed people. He worshiped every false god. He, you know, he was greedy. He was mean. He ruled Judah for 55 years. And because of his wickedness and the example that he set, Judah was never able to recover.
He did repent the last couple of years, didn't he?
Yeah, you can see that in the next line there.
Oh.
He personally repented, but it was too late. It was enough repentance for him to sneak into heaven without much, without many crowns. But it was not enough to change the situation that he had created in God's country. So God heard his prayer. Manasseh comes to know the Lord. Verse 14, he starts to rebuild the outer wall, and he fixes up Jerusalem. In verse 15, he removes the foreign gods, and he removes the idol that's been in the house of God during his tenure. And he throws all the idols outside. He grinds them into dust. He rebuilds the house of the Lord. He sets up the altar of the Lord and sacrifices peace offerings and thank offerings. He gets back to the way that Moses had commanded that they should worship in Jerusalem. And his prayer is over in the book of Kings. I'm not going to look at that, but he really and truly repents. And but once the country was gone, it was gone. And there was no getting it back at this point. So the days of Judah are numbered. Now, one thing about Manasseh, the Jewish oral history tells us that he took it upon himself to saw Isaiah in half with a saw. Not a very good way to go out. And the author of Hebrews refers to this when he talks about the martyrs, prophet martyrs of days gone by. He says they were stoned, they were sawn in two. This is a reference to Manasseh killing Isaiah. Well, it's not in the Bible, but I mean, why would they make something like that up? They just knew it. So after 55 years of the rule of Manasseh, he dies, and his son Amon, just like his father, longer. Then his son, Josiah, is a great guy. It says Josiah was 8 years old. Now, in Chronicles, I think it says 18.
It says when he turned 18, he requested the law or something. I read.
I think if you look in Chronicles, it says that he arose to be king at age 18. Here it says that he found the book of the law at age 18. But the only difference between 8 and 18 is a little jot. Now, Jesus said every jot and tittle, you know, the little markings on Hebrew. And so somebody left the little dot off or added it. I'm not sure which one. But the scholars are convinced that he was 8.
Well, he wouldn't have necessarily ruled. Wouldn't there have been a regent?
Yes, there was.
So when he was 18, then he would have been officially king.
Probably 13, bar mitzvah. But it doesn't say. But the point is that he did have proper upbringing, but his proper upbringing did not include the Bible, because the Bible was lost. The priests weren't doing their job anymore. And so Josiah knows intuitively to do the right thing, but he doesn't have the Bible to show him what to do. And so he did right, and he walked in the ways of his father David. He didn't turn to the right or to the left. And so he decides to do a building project in the temple. And so he sends people. Now, apparently there was a big jug of money there that people put in, probably, you know, silver and gold people put in there. And he said, go get the money out of there. It's amazing nobody stole it, or maybe it was guarded. I don't know. He said, go get the money out of there. So they took the money out, and they rolled it and took it to the bank, just like we do with our change. And in the bottom of this money collecting bin, they found the Bible. It says the book of the law. So I assume it was the Torah, the Pentateuch, the first five books. And, you know, that was supposed to be, you know, the stones of the Ten Commandments were supposed to be in the Ark of the Covenant, but they weren't. So they probably didn't even have a good knowledge of those. And so the guy, he hands the book to the scribe, who can read it, and he reads it, and then he brings the book to the king, and he reads the law in the ears of the king. And when he does, the king tears his clothes, Josiah. And he really was sensitive to what it meant, because there are blessings and curses. You know, cursed will you be in the field, cursed will your breadbasket be. And all these curses would come upon them because of what the things that he saw, you know, sacrificing children to foreign gods, and adulteries and homosexualities and murders and robberies and all of these things that were said to bring the curse of the law. And so, you know, in the New Testament, there's some theology about this. It says Jesus has become the curse of the law for us. And so that's how it relates here. But when Josiah, who's a young man, he sees this, he calls for the prophet. And he sees in the book that this wrath of God is burning against them, and that his ancestors have not listened to the words of the book to do according to it is written. But it was lost. But why was it lost? It was lost on purpose, because they didn't want to follow it. They didn't want to pay their tithes so that the priests could teach the law. They wanted to do what they wanted to do, and they didn't want to be constrained by the law. And so somebody hid this book. Obviously, it was the only one in captivity at the time. And it's funny that it was hidden under the money. You know, it's always the money. Follow the money, they say. You know, whatever's going on, follow the money. And so because he had this desire to fix up the house of God, he is given a greater revelation. And this will preach, you know, if we do a little thing that we know is the right thing to do, it will give us a greater opportunity, which is what happened here. And so, you know, that'll really work well in a sermon. So he consults God. And here's what God says. Because they have forsaken me and have burned incense to other gods, that they might provoke me to anger with all the work of their hands, therefore my wrath burns against this place. It shall not be quenched. And folks, I'm afraid the United States is at this point. I really am. But to the king of Judah, who sent you to inquire of the Lord, thus you shall say to him, thus says the Lord God of Israel, regarding the words that you've heard, because your heart was tender, you humbled yourself, when you hear what I spoke against this place, that they shall become a desolation, a curse, and have torn your clothes and wept before me, I've heard you, declares the Lord, therefore I will gather you to your fathers, and you will be gathered to your grave in peace. And your eyes will not see the evil I bring on this place. Whew. Yeah, but what about the kids? do the math on Kings 22:1. Thirty-nine years old. Murdered by Pharaoh Necho. That's how he escaped. I mean, this is discussion material. Would it have been better if Hezekiah had died and didn't get the 15 years? Because if he had, Manasseh would not have been born, and this whole thing would have not occurred, because Manasseh was the one that brought it down so that it couldn't recover.
Is that an example of praying not for God's will?
Apparently. And it's an example of God answering a prayer, even though,
yeah,
you know, because it was an honest prayer, he answered it. And so, you know, Josiah is here, you know, okay, you're not gonna see this. And certainly the prophet didn't tell him that in a few years, Pharaoh Necho is gonna come and kill you, which he did.
I have a question.
Yes.
Why was the son that was born that was 12 years old, why wasn't an older son become king? Why, you know, unless he didn't have any other kids?
I don't know the answer to that, because it doesn't say. It just says he died and Manasseh became king. And it doesn't mention other kids, I don't think, of Uzziah. I'd have to go back and look on that, but I don't know. Maybe he's reigned. Forgot how long Hezekiah reigned. Quite a while. Probably a young wife. I don't know, Jim. It doesn't say. I have to say, I don't know. So there's, in this chapter 23 and 24, there's a bunch of kings that, you know, became king and were king for 3 months, and then somebody killed him, and then this guy who killed him was raised up, and then somebody killed him, and then somebody killed him. And so at the end, it was, everybody was fighting to be king, but the country was doomed. And so at this point, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, comes up and he makes Judah a vassal state. Now, there's a proverb that says, don't throw your pearls before swine. And if you look at an earlier narrative in Kings or Chronicles, the Babylonians came, and the king of Judah took them into the temple of God and showed them all the gold furniture and the gold walls and all of the riches of the temple. So they went back, and then the legend was, wow, in this city is all this gold. They have so much gold, they don't know what to do with it. All we have to do is to go down there and take it. And so they came down. They stripped the temple of its gold, and they made this Jehoiakim a vassal king. And after 3 years, they deposed him because he rebelled against them. And then they came down, and they burned down the temple. They burned down the king's house. They deported all but the poorest people to Babylon. And as this is about to happen, prior to this event, Jeremiah is saying, don't resist. This is of God. Very unpopular message. And they kept arresting him, and they threw him in prison. And when they didn't like him in prison, they threw him in the well in prison so that the mud came up to his armpits. And they really persecuted him badly. And so Ezekiel, on the other hand, he sees it coming too. And he points out why it's coming. And then he sees the vision of God in the early chapters, the animals around the throne. We talked about, you know, the lion of the tribe of Judah and the man, the eagle and the ox that were in the encampment of the tabernacle. He sees the vision in heaven of that, tells the people. And Jeremiah prophesies that they will go into captivity. They'll come back in 70 years. Well, 70 years is a long time. It's like three generations. And so when Daniel went as a boy and he lived his whole life in Babylon during those 70 years, he was an old man when they were allowed to go back, and he was just a young boy when they were taken. And Daniel was taken because he was a member of the king's household. He was somehow related to the king. And so, you know, the Babylonians are the Iraqi people today, and they certainly know how to take hostages, and they've known how to take hostages for, you know, somewhere around 3,500 years or more. And so to keep Judah from causing them any problem, they took these kids and they taught them the language of the Babylonians and the culture and the literature of the Babylonians, and they tried to make them into Babylonians. And when Daniel and his friends refused to do that, then they, you know, lion's den, fiery furnace, all that kind of stuff. And so Jeremiah didn't have to go because he spoke the truth of God, and Nebuchadnezzar knew that he was preaching that they should not resist. And so the lamentations of Jeremiah are also about, you know, after it happened, he remained and he wrote Lamentations. In the Hebrew, excuse me, in the Hebrew Bible, I think they're one book. Hmm. So that is the end. Why did it happen? Because they didn't follow the one true God. Because they offered incense to the foreign gods. Because they worshiped the Baal and the Asheroth, which is a sexual god. You go to the temple and have sex with. They're the ones that would put the firstborn baby in a jar and put them in the cornerstone of the house. And so infanticide was a big problem. False religion, Molech, burning kids in fire. But one of the other things that is said is the cause is lack of Sabbath observance. Mm. It says in one place, I'm not sure where, I think it's in Jeremiah, it must be Jeremiah. They'll go into Babylon for 70 years until the land rests on all the Sabbaths that they failed to observe. So it was just a general disregard for humanity and a rebellion against the true God. And in the end, these people were supposed to know better. And they didn't. They were called. If you look at the call of Israel in Exodus 20, it says, "You shall be a kingdom of priests." It says the same thing about the church in Revelation chapter 1. A kingdom of priests. Their responsibility was to bridge the gap between the goyim, between the Gentiles and God, and present a moral, honest, loving theocracy on the earth as an example, and they failed miserably. Just as the church has failed miserably too. I mean, I don't want to put all the, you know, I don't want to be like the Germans who said, well, the Jews, God has cast the Jews off. He didn't cast the Jews off forever, and he brought them back after the 70 years, and Romans tells us he hasn't cast the Jews off forever, and they will come to know the Lord in the end. And so to be anti-Semitic about it is wrong. God loves the Jewish people. But never again did The never again were the people idolatrous after this. And it changed Judaism completely because there was no sacrifice anymore. There was no temple anymore. There were no, I mean, there were Levites, but they weren't being paid to teach. And so the religion of Judaism changed from a temple Judaism to a synagogue Judaism while they were in Babylon, because they couldn't do their sacrifices. And so they had to rework and to worship God in a way that was permitted. And so the synagogue developed. And as the synagogue developed, there were leaders called rabbis. And eventually, when they got back into Judea, there were two arms of Judaism. There was rabbinic Judaism, which was synagogue Judaism, and there was temple Judaism. And we have names for those two people, those two groups. They are called the Sadducees and the Pharisees. And the Sadducees only took the first five books of the Bible because that's what Moses said, and because those are the books that gave them their authority. And the synagogue people said, yeah, but a lot of stuff has happened since then, you know, ergo Judges and Kings, and, you know, they list all these other books. So they accepted all the books, and therefore they came to understand that there were angels, and they came to understand that there was resurrection from the dead and so forth. And so it split Judaism in two. So since the temple has been destroyed in 70 by Titus, there's only been rabbinic Judaism. But of course, that's been split into three groups now too, which are Orthodox, Conservative, and Reform. But they all still have rabbis, so they're all part of rabbinic Judaism. Are there any questions or comments?
Yeah, would you mind going over that again?
Which part?
The different rabbinic, the temple.
Okay.
When they coming back from Babylon and how?
Okay, the temple was destroyed. The gold was taken off first, and then after they came back after 3 years, they destroyed it. They tore down all of the building, and then it was later rebuilt by Ezra. And then it was added on to for 40 some years by Herod. So the New Testament temple is actually the third temple. So we have our tabernacle, our Solomon's temple, then we have the Ezra temple, and then we have Herod's temple. So because the temple was destroyed during those 70 years and they were not there, the only way that they could worship would be in a congregational setting like we do. Our pattern is based on rabbinic Judaism. You know, you have a rabbi, which is another word for a pastor, mm-hmm. teaching pastor. And so there were certain people that they had to have, board members and stuff like that. And so during that 70 years, the rabbinic Judaism was the only thing that existed. But then after the deportation, excuse me, I'm losing my voice. After the deportation, they went back and Ezra rebuilt the temple so they could do the sacrifices again. So during that time period, they had competing Judaisms. They had the congregationally based and they had the temple based. And because the temple based was the one that was authorized in Moses, and the congregationally based, no scripture to support its creation. So it was a creation of necessity. And, you know, as Judaism grew in later days, you know, when Jews moved to different cities throughout the known world, they created synagogues because they couldn't make a trip to Jerusalem three times a year to worship at the temple. And so as a result, the Sadducees, who were the priests and who were ruling the temple at the time of Christ, were the descendants of these of temple Judaism. And they thought that synagogue Judaism or rabbinic Judaism was a novel experiment and did not have the authority of their leadership. Okay. And so therefore was not, you know, up to snuff in their opinion. And so the fact that Jesus was a rabbi automatically put him at a disadvantage with these people, because they didn't accept the idea that synagogue was allowed. And so the Pharisees, who Jesus was a Pharisee, and most evangelical Christians are Pharisees, and you know, they get cut down for their arrogance sometimes. But the Pharisees, because they were congregationally based under teaching rabbis, they read these other books. They read Joshua. They read Judges. They read Kings. They read the prophets, the writings, the book of Job. All of those things were not accepted by the Sadducees. We're only going to accept the five books. Mm-hmm. They're Christians today. Throw the Old Testament away, we're only going to accept the New Testament. Or there's even some that say, we're only going to accept the four Gospels. And so if you do that, then, you know, you're only going to have a part of it. Mm-hmm. Because whatever books that you accept, I mean, evangelicals accept the fact that God works supernaturally. Sadducees did not. So evangelicals are pitted against Christian liberals because Christian liberals don't believe in the miraculous. They believe in science only and whatever you can determine from your reason. And so nothing has really changed. The names are different.
Yes.
But we're in the same boat that we've always been in. Did you get it that time?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Anything else? Okay, next week we will talk about the rebuilding of the temple under Ezra, the rebuilding of Jerusalem under Nehemiah, and the story of Esther, which is even later. Anything else? God bless. Thank you for showing up. It's always fun.
Pastor Kevin, I just want to let you know that me and my family are going to be at Cooperstown next Sunday, so we're not going to be here.
Okay. You know, if you go to the church page, the main page on the church, click on Old Testament Survey, mm-hmm. and the list of these lessons comes up, and you can listen to it at your leisure.
Okay, thank you.
You get to go this year.
We're going to socially distance in our cabin. My dad's coming up with my brother, so we'll get to see and celebrate his 90th like we were supposed to.
Oh, that'll be fun.
Yeah.
Okay. Have a good week.
You too.
Okay.
Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.